IVM.
The Cred store has been hooked. Specially curated products from over 250 brands and the use of Cred coins to avail exclusive offers and deals across categories like food and beverages, electronics or home decor, etc. That means if you're buying electronics or home decor, it's a discount city. So don't miss out. Download the Cred app now. Folks, welcome to Paisa Paisa, presented by Cred, the most rewarding credit card bill payments app and powered by Quarter. I'm your host Anupam Gupta, B50 on Twitter, and my guest today is Ravi Ravalapathy, CEO Capita. And today we are going to talk about ESOPs, cap tables, whole lot of startup stuff and a lot more right after this short Cred convenience break. Your computer can be compromised in many ways, and all cyber attacks ultimately affect your files and apps by accessing everything that's on your PC. Intel vPro keeps you safe from cyber attacks using the Intel Hardware Shield, which has three groups of capabilities. First, advanced threat protection, quickly detecting issues like ransomware and crypto mining. Second, below the OS security, identifying unauthorized changes to hardware. And lastly, application and data protection, preventing malware injections. So, secure your organization's productivity with Intel vPro's hardware-based security. Visit intel.in/ITheroes to know more. Remember Intel vPro, it's built for business. Ravi, welcome to Paisa Paisa. Thank you so much for doing this for our list.
Thank you so much for having me on Paisa Paisa, Anupam.
Thank you, Ravi. Quick intro to you, your background, to Capita, what it does. Of course, we'll go much into detail into Capita in the second half, but just give us maybe a 2-minute intro to you and Capita.
Anupam, I grew up in Hyderabad, studied at IIT and IIM, and then went on to become an investment banker. So you can think of me as a banker for about 17, 18 years before starting Capita. At Capita, we are building a full-fledged module for digital equity management that includes ESOPs, cap tables, and in future building liquidity solutions for private companies and their stakeholders.
Yeah. That's interesting. That was really quick. Okay, now let's just take a few steps back and understand the use case here, Ravi. Let's start. You have two broad products. There's Captable and there's ESOPs. Let's start with the hotter topic, which is ESOPs, okay? It's a bit of a tricky topic, isn't it? And a lot of times it's not even understood probably by the founders and by the employees. So from your perspective, from the work that you are doing with your product, let's look at both sides of the table. Why do you guys think, or do you guys, assuming you think, where are the specific problems or challenges or areas of misunderstanding from the startup founder's point of view and from the employee point of view for ESOPs?
Absolutely, Anupam. So I think the central, if you get to the core of employee stock ownership plans or employee stock option plans. Essentially, it's about ownership of the company. The moment the company and the founders treat it as an ownership within the company, then it becomes very straightforward for both. The moment you treat it as something else, it's like an extended form of compensation, or it's an extended form of, if you treat it as any other instrument than ownership in the company, then you feel that there are, differences on how a company thinks about it and how an employee thinks about it. And so I think part of what we are doing is treating employee ownership for what it is. It's essentially a part of the company and therefore related very closely to the cap table. And that's how we conceive of the product. Used quote, if you're looking for returns, think like an investor. If you're an employee, employees will look at like compensation. But if you are like an owner, you think of contribution. So the moment you get everything onto that kind of central thesis, you don't find that many conflicts. The framework becomes easy both for employees as well as for founders and managers of this equity or ESOP plans within companies. I think I will leave that at there when we'll discuss this in more detail.
My next question is related to that. I mean, look at what you said, right? You said compensation, contribution, and return. All three are like so totally different when you look at it as attributes of something like an ESOP, So let's dig a little bit deeper. I mean, you're also a founder now and you've been an investment banker. So I'm sure you've spoken to a lot of founders and your product is meant for startups. So you would be talking to them on a regular basis, right? So what are the best practices here?
Yeah,
and let's try and break it down, because there are three or four very specific events in an ESOP cycle, right? One is granting, second is vesting, third is exercising, right? And all three are very different from both sides of the table. Let's get your perspective on that.
Absolutely. So I'll start with one more stage, which is design of the plan itself. So first of all, put the constraints on design of the plan. What is your employee stock option plan? What percentage? And that's where you interact with shareholders. Essentially, you are carving out a piece of the company and distributing it to your employees. And therefore, you have to kind of think what is, acceptable to your shareholders and so on. And so the best practices there, if you see the best, largest, the companies that have actually used ESOPs really well, that range we have generally seen across the world and even in this part of the world for successful companies between 5% to 15% of the company, and in some cases a little bit higher, actually being allocated towards employee incentives.
So can I assume that a floor of 5% is good?
Yeah, I think so. If you draw a normal kind of curve for successful startups which have implemented this, you will find most of them like that. That will be your five sigma range kind of thing, between 5%. So it's not like anything less than a 5% kind of thing, then you are not have a significant employee ownership. So that is where creating the pool and so on. So design kind of architects across all of the stages you mentioned, but first you have to kind of the construct of ownership. What percentage of ownership do you want to give employees and so on? And then comes the next part, which is part of design, which is distribution. So are you giving ownership to rank and file in the company? Are you giving to frontline or are you giving to senior people within the company? And that's another decision a founder has to take in terms of so. And so if you want to think of everybody needs to think of from a contribution perspective, you want to give the ESOPs to everyone. If you want only a few people to actively think of contribution perspective, then you kind of restrict it to fewer people.
Kind of reminds me of Narayan Murthy, right? Very famous story of Infosys of him having given his gardener and his driver. And I thought that created a lot of goodwill here. It's a very feel-good kind of thing, right?
Absolutely, including, and there is a story also about the Facebook, the guy who designed the like button. Was actually given options because Facebook couldn't pay him at that time. At least there's a story going around at the time of IPO. I started my career. I worked with Infosys for a year at the very start of my career. So all the way back. So I can actually, I know what it meant because this was a big story at that time. And Infosys, Wipro, some of these companies pioneered this in the Indian ecosystem itself in terms of ESOPs. And at that time, they were still listed companies. So it was going into the listed company territory. So if you want this feeling of rank and file and ownership of the company to seep through the organization, then you want to kind of go for org-wide ESOPs. And that's the trade-off. And sometimes people find between quantum versus distribution and so on. The other thing was managing for systems. And now that people like ourselves and our competitors are creating the systems, you can actually afford to do this on not on paper and not on spreadsheets and actually use systems to manage, which makes it easier to kind of go wider distribution. The second aspect is granting. So granting has two elements to it, actually to who you grant and how much you grant. So I kind of talked about it. And so now there are best practices in terms of if you want to go, across the organization, how do you kind of structure it? And so you, from a company's perspective, there's always a constraint of the pool, which is allocated by the shareholders, which is at 5 to 15%. And from an employee perspective, how much, and both parties have to understand that, this is a tool for future value creation. You're getting a share of the company. And as you contribute to the value of the company and you grow, this will grow. And if you're part of a successful company, then actually what has been proven and significant amount of wealth has gotten created through these instruments in the Silicon Valley and any other startup ecosystem that has been successful. So it has happened in the US, it has happened in China, it is happening now in India, it will happen in Indonesia and any other startup market that kind of prospers. So this will be a significant wealth creation tool in the longer term, and that is what will energize the entire ecosystem. And the third part is vesting. The typical best practices we have seen is four-year vesting. It's almost become a norm across listed and unlisted companies. So you vest over 4 years. And now there are other things around vesting like cliffs and so on. If you want to be really proactive and employee friendly, you'll go for monthly vesting, no cliff period. typically you want to actually, when you get a new employee on board, you will have in what is typical HR practice, you have a probation period, company getting to know the person and so on. And therefore the cliff is the equivalent of that concept in the ESOP, you know, in the ESOP, you know, ESOP domain. And that is basically, let us get to know your contribution and so on. So if you've been with the company for at least a year, it starts to kick in, and then you have a 4-year vesting period. Very rarely we have seen 5 years, 7 years as well. And, you know, aggressively when you're actually trying to get talent that you can't afford, you may actually give up upfront ESOPs. But the norm, again, if you draw typical ESOP plan, will have a 4-year vesting schedule. It's almost becoming the standard.
But that 4-year excludes the so-called cliff or probation period, you're saying.
Includes, right? So it includes.
So it's 1+3 then.
Yeah, it's 1+3. That is almost the standard that we are seeing. There are always exceptions. There can be reasons 1+4, 5, 1+3, depending
on. So the vesting happens then at the last day of 4th year.
The vesting happens at a cliff, which is the first anniversary, and then on a quarterly basis, annual basis, or monthly basis.
It spreads out.
Pro rata. And if you want to be really proactive and friendly to the employees, then you go for monthly vesting so that it's like a true pro rata in some sense.
Just like your salary.
Now, this is time-based vesting, and sometimes there'll be performance-based vesting, which means it is linked to your performance objectives, and therefore you hit a certain milestone, that's when the vesting happens. So there's time and there is a performance. A good kind of balance is to have a combination of both for employees. Like
performance is a little bit hard to define. I mean, what if the pandemic hits, I'm getting screwed for something that's not in my hands.
Yeah, so you have to understand that this is finally about the value of the company growing. So if your ESOPs have to mean something, the company has to perform, and therefore you have to think like an owner too when you think of ESOP, that it is a collective thing. Then you collectively create value; value gets created, and that's where the balance is between the employee perspective and the employer perspective. Oh. And the last one you mentioned is exercise. So where we have seen is like lack of transparency around exercise can actually hurt the longer term prospects. Finally, exercise is, you're giving an option because the option can convert into a share of the company. And so having full transparency around how an employee eventually creates value around exercise of the ESOPs and so on is really important if you want employees to believe in your ESOP program. And that is also, and therefore designing the rules. So what happens if a person leaves? Ideally, he should keep the vested options with him for forever to kind of vest exercise. But the person and exercise prices can be artificially set as very high. Again, that will not be helpful. And that is where we see there are, some scope for evangelization to adopt more best practices than not. And that is when wealth gets created through this asset class. And I'm talking of compensation like salary. Actually, wealth getting created from this asset class is when we have truly evangelized ESOP. So I can get into each one of these topics and discuss in detail. But I'll probably
some more questions. We'll probably keep that for another episode. One last question before we go into the cap table, Ravi.
Mm-hmm.
Liquidity. You know, yeah. The options are vested, and I have actually, so I now have those shares, or I bought the shares with me. They're there in my DMAT, all the physical shares and certificates, depending on, what system is followed by people. What happens after that? In some cases, it's almost worthless paper to me because there's no aftermarket for it, right?
Yes.
At least things today are much better because there is, in case of some startup, there is an unlisted market. But there again, founders can be nasty. Right. So just let's go into that, because that I think is a little bit important.
Anupam, we have hit the bullseye into our motivation to start Capita. So what we've seen is happening is company becomes private, multiple large rounds of private funding happen. Companies stay private for much longer. When I started my career as a banker, the average time to IPO was 6 years. The global average time to IPO today is 12 years. And in our part of the world, it is actually 12, 14, 15 years. So company actually exists in the private form for a really long time. And the true picture of ownership was managed in these spreadsheets, which were cap tables and ESOPs, rather than on systems. And we saw in the most developed part of the world, every startup is starting to use systems for these. and it's not widely adopted. And that was one motivation. The second motivation is the liquidity. So ESOPs, I mentioned, typical vesting schedules are 4 years. So you have these 4 year vested options and company stays private for 14, 15 years without liquidity events happening. And then how do you, how do you make this paper contract or a contract that you have with the employee mean something for the employee? There has to be liquidity. So one of the motivations why, you know, every other part of a bank had got disrupted by technology, except the part of the bank that I worked in. And for me, the bee in the bonnet was how will technology change this aspect of banking? And through ESOP systems and cap table systems, we saw how transactions get impacted. And the way transactions get impacted is actually providing liquidity. So what in our roadmap, it's not one part is building the software. We actually want to provide liquidity solutions to employees and stakeholders, which can be early investors in startups as well. How do they get liquidity before waiting for the 12, 14 year period? And that benefits the ecosystem as a whole, because you're actually, the capital gets recycled with respect to early investors and employees stay. So today, if you are a solid engineer, you can get offers from a Google, an Amazon, a Microsoft, or a Swiggy, or a Paytm, or any of the private companies.
With the super bike thrown in.
Potentially with a super bike or two thrown in and a vacation. So if you're looking at that situation, then your ESOP should mean the same as a listed company ESOP. And therefore, there has to be structured liquidity for your ESOPs. So part of what we're building on top of the ESOP management itself is a structured liquidity. Can a company go and say, every quarter or every year, company will buy back X percent of its ESOPs back from the employees? And for that, the company needs to have its own parameters. And can we actually build a software that where you can run this whole process on the software itself? Can we take it a step further and let investors actually participate in that buyback so they can actually get exposure to that company as well? And so that's basically the next step in terms of where we are headed.
Okay. Absolutely. Last question before we, wrap this first part of this episode is cap table. So this year and the last one, I think for the last 18 months, startups have been raising money right, left, and center. What used to be a once in a year event is now thrice in a year event, if not more. Cap tables can become really tricky or difficult to handle, right? I mean, what's your view out here?
Yeah, absolutely. So the asset class, which has grown at a cumulative annual growth rate, a CAGR of 45% over the last 20 years, is private cap tables. So value of private cap tables and very few asset classes over a 20 year period would have grown at 45%. And in the past, this was driven by the US startup ecosystem, then China, India's time has come, and we are seeing that happening in the Indian ecosystem. Take that one step further. We actually think today the market capitalization somewhere between 300 to 500 billion will be the private market capitalization. That will be somewhere upwards of 1 trillion in the Indian market.
And, so you're saying that India's entire startup ecosystem is valued at $1 trillion?
Will be valued at $1 trillion
at some point of time. And right now it's about 300 to 400 billion.
Correct. Wow. And that is how big this will become. And this is aligned with, national goals. This is basically how we see the startup ecosystem grow. And that is reflective. What you're seeing in terms of funding and all of that is the micro manifestation of this longer term trend. And so if there's $1 trillion sitting in the private markets and there's IPOs happen 12 kind of 14 year cycles, then the liquidity solutions have to come. Not just that, the instruments through which ownership is managed have to be managed on systems, and that is where the cap table. For us, we look at, we don't have like a separate product for cap table and ESOP. For us, it's ownership in a company. A system should tell you what is the true ownership of a company at any point in time. Your ROC filing or in other markets in Singapore, the ACRA filing, don't actually reflect the true ownership of a company. The true ownership of a company is on the cap table plus the ESOP details. And so we're building one system for integrated view of ownership of a company. And within cap tables, because you do these multiple rounds, you have Series A, Series B, Series C. Each one of them is a separate class of shares. So understanding properties of those classes of shares and how they interplay with other instruments. And then you have options on top. You also may have convertible notes, warrants. So understanding all of that comprehensively on the system is how we are trying to build. And this is how we differentiate from our competitors as well.
Folks, and that's it. In the next part of this episode, we're going to jump directly into the product. We're going to talk about how Capita manages all of what Ravi said, ESOP management, cap table. So we're going to take a small break out here, a small great convenience break. My guest, Ravi Ravulapati, CEO Capita. We'll be right back.
$100. That's all it takes to begin your journey with Bitcoin and Ethereum. No, really. With CoinSwitch, you can start investing in over 100 cryptocurrencies with just 100 rupees. On top of that, there are zero charges for deposits and withdrawals, so you can trade, buy, sell, however and whenever you want. All of this, plus their extremely intuitive interface, makes CoinSwitch the perfect app for beginners in the crypto space. But don't take my word for it. Just download CoinSwitch for free and try it out for yourself. If you'd like more information on cryptocurrencies, tune into A Show About Crypto with me, Rohan Joshi, my new adventure on IVM Podcasts. CoinSwitch, kuch to badlega.
Folks, we've got a listener question.
Hey Anupam, I'm tracking global companies and I want to check out their latest investor releases. Where can I do that?
Yep, I hear you, man. You know, all of us are tracking global companies these days. Our portfolios have become diversified. We're investing in global stocks. And if you want to track the global companies, you know, big companies like a Tesla or Apple or a Facebook or a Google, you would want to check out their quarterly results, right? And the investor releases, which has a conference call and presentation, analyst presentations and stuff like that. Where do you do that? Well, you've got the Quarter app. The Quarter app gives you a big exposure to global companies also. So if there's any company in the US, you will get it on the Quarter app sitting here in India. And that means the result table, the investor presentation, the conference call, all of that on the Quarter app. That's Quartr. And welcome back to Paisa Paisa, folks. My guest, Ravi Ravulapati, CEO Capita. Ravi, let's do it now. Okay, let's jump directly into your product. Walk our listeners through Capita. And, you know, let's say, like we did in the first half, let's start with how Capita manages the ESOPs for a startup.
Absolutely. So the way we manage ESOPs for a company is everything from design. Once you have an idea of how much is your ESOP pool and what plan, then what happens is the next step for you is to create an ESOP plan or an ESOP scheme. So you can create that electronically within the system. You can put in all the parameters, which typically takes care of things like what is the default vesting schedule for anyone getting from the scheme? What are the rules around exit? So if an employee leaves, what happens? What happens to vested? What happens to unvested? All of those rules are captured on the system itself. This is plans. Companies will have 2020 plan, 2021 plan, and so on, right? You can create multiple plans as you go along. So that is step one. Second, you can electronically grant ESOPs on the system, which means if I have 200 employees and 200 employees need grants, you can electronically award. If you need to bulk upload them from a spreadsheet or an employee database that you have, you can upload it. You can create the rules. You can set the grants and you can electronically grant them as a workflow. If you have issued offline and you're moving on to Capita, you can actually just read all of that from a spreadsheet into the system and the system will be ready in very short order. Then once you have all of these, we actually use this for employee engagement as well. So every employee gets their own login. They can see their awards. They can actually simulate what's the value of their ESOPs, what's the tax they may need to pay if they exercise their ESOPs. So all of those simulation tools and employee gets a dashboard, employee gets details, all the documents, all the signed documents are on the system. So there is no searching for any letter, which is it lying with the employee, is it lying with you? It's an electronic system of record and it is an employee can see. We are also using this to do innovative things around employee engagement around ESOP. So if salary gets a payslip, and equity vesting should get an equity payslip and it should tell you what's the value. And if you stay with the company for the next 2 years, what is the number of ESOPs going to be? So all those simulators and widgets are built into the system and that you can manage. Now, ESOP actually impacts three different parts of a company. And early in the stage of a company, this is lost on founders and you figure it out as you go along. It impacts your cap table and your corp dev because it's ownership in the company. It impacts finance and accounting because you have to account for stock compensation expense. And that depends on vesting schedules and all of that. So many times when we show this to larger, more like later stage startups, we are pitching to the founder, to the CFO's team, and also to the CHRO's team. So that's the third department, the HR team, because it's the ESOP management, it's also kind of seen as employee compensation and therefore, HR gets involved as well. So all of them get their respective views, and you can click a button to get accounting reports on the ESOPs. You can, so one click of a button, you want Indian accounting standards, you can get that. You have IFRS, you can get IFRS reports, and so on. But the next step for us is to actually integrate with valuation of companies and like the accounting valuation, tax valuation purposes. You need valuations for ESOPs and tax and so on. So tying up with providers of those to actually automate that, or at least semi-automate that on the platform. So that's what we're building towards. That's what you can get on ESOPs.
Do employees get happy birthday emails also? I'm sorry for slipping that in, because you mentioned HR. Reminded me of a very different era in my life where, you know, on everybody's birthday, you would have a happy birthday mail from HR. So just kidding, by the way.
But we do think actually employee engagement around ESOPs is a big area. That's how you can differentiate and explain like this is lost. So we may have some confetti on the system.
I get what you're saying. You know, in fact, I just now, when you mentioned the detail in which you are going to when it comes to ESOPs and having an employee have his own dashboard, okay, where he can actually track the value of his investments, of his ESOPs. I'm just trying to think, what's your customer, you know, right? Because you mentioned Series B, C. So I'm guessing that for someone who's still in the angel or in the seed or in the pre-series around, it's a little bit early for him. Am I right?
Actually, we want to get our customers as early as possible. So the thing is, this becomes complex. The moment you have more than 15 employees with ESOPs, it starts to become complex. So the way we build it is freemium. So if a startup with just two founders wants to use our system for their cap table and their ESOPs, it's free until you hit a certain number of shareholders or ESOP holders, and then you start paying. So that's we are actually helping us, the companies, when they are young and they're organized, and they can actually grow with the system. And that's how it's designed. So the intention for us is to handle all the way from inception, like incorporation to IPO. Today, we just stop short of IPO. We just deal with private companies. But soon, we are actually going to build features that listed companies can also use. So we can say you can go all the way from inception to IPO.
Sure. Very interesting. Cap tables. Let's talk about how Capita handles that.
So cap tables is like, it's really... So cap tables, we built it as a self-serve. So if you want to use it, you can put in your cap table and so on. But what we actually... Where we actually differentiate is we actually... do equivalent of a legal due diligence when we onboard a customer on Captable, which means we'll tell you your Captable is slightly different from your ROC filings, and therefore there is some discrepancy. There's a missing share certificate, or we don't actually see the corresponding share certificate or a number. But let's start one step back. Captable essentially has multiple securities. It has common shares, then it has your CCPS or compulsory convertible preference shares, and each preference share can have a liquidation preference, which is quite common as you go for venture type of funding, Series A, Series B, Series C, and so on. It can have a multiplier. You can have a convertible note somewhere in between two rounds and all of that. So what we do is we not only capture, we record, a cap table is nothing but a series of transactions. We actually record every transaction from inception of a company on the system. If all transactions are correct, the ownership is correct and the cap table is correct. And that's how we build up to the cap table. And so we provide this as a service to companies. Our customer is a company. It can be an early stage company, late stage company. And for the company, we record all transactions from inception. And investors will get appropriate views. So investor can also look into the cap table in real time and have the latest information. And this can be garbage in, garbage out, which is why we actually help companies onboard. We actually do the equivalent of legal DD when we onboard. And because you have all properties of every share class, you can actually run any deal scenarios. You want to simulate the next round. I will raise the next round at so-and-so valuation, so much money. What's my dilution? What's my ESOP pool? How much ESOPs do I need to top up to get to that percentage? All of those simulations can now be done on the system. And you can click a button to download what's equivalent of a financial model, which either a VC analyst or an investment banking analyst would have done for you.
Nice. Very interesting. It's good you've said this, because that leads me to the next question, which is that how is your product different from other products out there? Or let's put this in a different perspective. Okay, founders have this entire cost pressures and buying stuff, and software is typically expensive these days, especially stuff that is useful. So they would tend to use, like you said, a Microsoft Excel sheet to do all of this work. Okay. So could you just make the case out here for actually investing in Capita making sense for founders?
So I will address that in two. First of all, we are talking about ownership of your company. The second most important thing after you start the company is the team. The third most important thing is actually who owns the company and how you'll do and so on. So it's actually, we're talking about something like ownership of a company. And the more you use systems to manage it, it'll be accurate and it'll be one big, it actually is a multi-department kind of issue. So it'll impact your finance. It'll impact your, corp dev. It will also impact your HR and ultimately your team and your employees. And therefore, managing it on systems is essential. Now, at the same time, we are conscious that you are a startup. And therefore, our pricing model should reflect how startups can afford it. And that's how it is designed. So our goal is not actually to just make... Capita's aim is not to actually make software and charge some hefty amount for the software and make our returns from that. We actually think software is only a wedge. We are actually digitizing what is managed on paper. The bigger problem to solve is how do transactions happen? How does that liquidity problem get solved? How does an employee who's been there for 3 years, has vested and has moved on to some other place, actually get liquidity for his shares? And same for early stage investors. And that is where when liquidity is being provided for on the platform is where we think we'll actually monetize and make. And so the platform itself is designed and is very startup friendly in terms of pricing. In fact, very early stage, until you grow to a reasonable size, you don't pay on the platform. And so that's the two aspects in terms of.
Very interesting. Where can our listeners reach out to you, if they're interested in signing up?
Ravi at capita.com, capitacorp.com. At capitacorp.com, there's request for demo. If you just click there, someone will reach out to you and call you. You can reach out to us on LinkedIn or on Twitter. There is enough people actually who will look for these kind of inbound requests, and we will organize a demo for you. I'm happy to share some links to videos and so on once this goes online.
The social media details and credentials are there in the description of this episode. And folks, it's Capita with a Q. Okay. Q-A-P-I-T-A. Right, Avi?
Absolutely.
Okay. Avi, one last question before we wrap up, since we're talking about liquidity. Where does this go from here? Right? Because startups are only going to become much more important. And if you don't have pools of liquidity created for employees, for employees to sell their shares, this kind of becomes a locked-in thing. And we've had a few unsavory episodes in the last, 2-3 years, fairly high-profile ones, which people might have different points of view. But it is what it is. There is a situation here where a lot of locked-up wealth can be unlocked if there is either an exchange, which can't happen, I guess, because SEBI won't apply here. The exchanges won't apply here because these are not listed companies, right? And then there are complications like from a startup's perspective, if you create this, your competitor can just come and pick up a few, take a stake in your company and you wouldn't even know about it. In your view, where does this go? Yeah, over the next 5-10 years, you're saying that startup value in India is set to go from where we are right now, which is 300 billion to about a trillion maybe in the next decade or whatever the number is. How do we address this? Where do you think this is going?
So there will be rails built for private markets. There will be technology-driven solutions on how liquidity can be handled. And our thesis here is to give the power back to the startup in some sense. Have a system where... So the first instance of solving liquidity before going all the way to what can be termed as a private exchange is issuer-driven liquidity. So how can the issuer, which is the company, actually have systems or platforms that they can access where if they want to provide liquidity to some of their employees, there is access and rails built. And because this is all paper-based and this is all based on how a private market transaction gets, how the buyer meets the seller, how the transaction happens, how it's settled is all an offline process. And I know it only too well because I've been a banker for 17 years just making a living out of solving this problem. On an offline basis, but we think they're already rails built. So if you look at the US, almost four or five platforms have emerged. Actually, most leading exchanges in the world have taken positions in these platforms. Most leading banks in the world have taken positions in these platforms. So we don't think the wheel is being reinvented here. We are building it for Indian roads. That's how we think of this. And so I think that's basically how we see. So the rails will get built. There'll be systems where it's easier to meet for buyers and systems and sellers to meet. And I'll give you an example. If the entire cap table and ESOP is being managed on a software system, and that is actually our bigger vision here. If there are 1,000 startups, there are at least 50,000 equity holders on the platform, 50,000 buyers and sellers and owners of equity. And therefore, how easy or difficult will it be at that point in time to actually have build ability for people to buy and sell, and all within the accepted rules of the regulator in that particular market? That's how we see how this problem gets addressed. So someone will build it. It will be Capita or someone else, but rails will be built.
And the regulator will happen also, because right now there's no regulator. It's the Wild West out there.
Progressively, there'll be some regulation in terms and limits in terms of how, because ultimately this is significant wealth creation. And then you should think, should this wealth creation be accessible to a larger group of investors? So that problem will come up. And when that problem comes up, regulators will also come kind of make a play. Yeah.
There you go, folks. If you're a founder or if you're an employee of a startup, I hope you found this useful. Let's hope that that exchange or that platform or that liquidity happens for all of you startup people, where you can unlock your shares and your wealth out there. And that's a wrap on this episode of Paisa Vaisa. My guest, Ravi Ravulapati, CEO, Capita. Ravi, thank you so much. Thank you so much for doing this for our listener.
Thank you, Anupam.
And now, the cred privilege tip of the week. Folks, invest in yourself. What I mean by that is, understand investing terms. You saw in this episode, we spoke about exercising of options of ESOPs and investing and a whole lot of stuff. So there's a lot of terms out there which might be a little bit difficult to understand. It's always a good thing to understand, explore, you know, and research into key investing terms. And there's a whole way that you can do that. There's stuff on Google, there are books. So please read up, inform yourself, and strengthen your knowledge base before you start investing, and also as an ongoing process. Hopefully, our podcast helps you to do that. So that's a cred privilege tip of the week. And thank you, listeners, for listening to this episode. If you're enjoying this show, please do share it with your friends, family, and people that you know. That would be really helpful for us. You can listen to this show and other interesting shows on the IVM Podcast app or ivmpodcast.com. You can also follow us on our social media. We are IVM Podcast on Twitter and Instagram. And if you want to reach out to me, I'm your host, Anupam Gupta, B50 on Twitter and B_50 on Instagram. Thank you so much for listening to Paisa Vaisa, presented by Cred, the most rewarding credit card bill payments app, and powered by Quartum.
No material on the show should be considered as financial advice. The material on the show is for informational purposes only. Please consult a financial advisor before taking any investment decision.
Hi, everybody. Just wanted to ask everyone for a quick favor. We're running a brand survey right now and would really appreciate it if you could let us know what you think about the advertising on IVM. Go to ivmpodcast.com/survey and do let us know. As part of this, we'll be selecting 10 random participants and sending them some IVM swag. So do fill out those surveys.
Hello, everybody. It's been another great week on the IVM Podcast Network. This week on Khel Neeti, Vinod Kambli joins Rajiv Mishra and Nikhil Chopra. They discuss India's terrible loss against New Zealand and the team's strategy ahead. This week on Marathi Kitkitun, Dr. Rajiv and Manik Deshmukh are joined by Shekhar Naniwadekar to talk about the Raigarh Fort in Maharashtra. On Smarter with Sid, Siddharth sheds light on how we can build and utilize that ever-elusive quality personal soft power. And on Shunya One, Sheila Ditya and myself talk to Rajat Chikar, co-founder of DealShare. We discuss the journey of DealShare and how the e-commerce audiences have evolved over time. Do follow us on social media. We're IVM Podcast on Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, and LinkedIn. And remember, if you're enjoying this show or any of our other shows for that matter, please do tell a friend. And finally, we'd like to thank our sponsors on the network this week: Cred, Bank of Baroda, Quartr, CoinSwitch, Kuberos, Slate Coffee, Intel, Kotak Mahindra Bank, and Oxfam India. Thank you so much for making this possible.
If you're a cricket fan, check out Edges and Sledges, India's favorite cricket podcast.
The podcast focuses on Indian cricket, the IPL, and has a ton of banter both on and off the field.
We talk about the week's biggest cricket stories with current and ex-international cricketers, coaches, or sometimes just between us.
And it's hosted by me, DJ.
Me, Varun.
And me, Ashwin.
New episodes release every week.
You can catch us on the IVM Podcasts website, app,
or wherever you get your podcasts from.
Check out the Edges and Sledges Cricket Podcast.